Hello everyone, and welcome back to AMOS, our course on Agile methods and open source. After discussing product management and Scrum's product owner in part 4 of this course, we will now turn to software development and the software developer in part 5. This is the first section on planning and other techniques of software development in Scrum. So we will talk about the software developer, its different planning activities, similarly or complementary to the product owner. And we will look at some engineering techniques before in the second section of this fifth part, we will look at some more of the process practices. So the software developer is actually originally the software development team in Scrum. Scrum 2020 changed this for the team to be the product owner and the developers, but within the overall team, there's still the software development team. And its job is, as one logical entity, to deliver the software. In the sense that there's a requirement by Scrum that the team as a whole, functions as a whole, that's an important goal, and thereby commits as a team every sprint to deliver some useful software. So to remind you, a software developer in Scrum is really supercharged and combines these different functions or roles from what's traditionally separately viewed as engineering management, software development, and quality assurance. A software developer in Scrum allocates work by themselves. So there's no engineering manager who tells them who gets to do what. They decide how to do it. Each developer decides how to do it. So there's no subordinate, superior software architect who tells everyone how to do things. And also, software developers in Scrum are responsible for maintaining a high quality, so that the release decision can be cast with good conscience. And that means that there's no separate quality assurance department. So you can see how these three traditional roles map onto what a software developer individually, but then the software development team as a whole does in Scrum. So, sprint planning. We already know that we have a sprint planning meeting in which the team commits to the sprint backlog, the features to be done in the upcoming sprint. And it is the result of the sprint planning meeting what makes it into that sprint backlog. And the next follow-on step then for software developers is to pick each of these features one after another or in parallel depending on the number of people and, well, implement them. And often such implementation is not only taking the feature as a whole, but means breaking down a more complex feature into different tasks. Now, in AMOS, we specifically say or ask that a single feature is supposed to be small enough. That's the S and the invest criteria for good feature descriptions, specifications. Is small enough so that it can be done within one sprint. So there is no official need to break something down into tasks, but nevertheless, developers may still want to do that. Product owners specify features and software development teams commit to implementing features within one sprint. But then for the planning of a sprint, developers outside of the team meeting or the sprint planning meeting or thereafter can still decide to break down features further into tasks. These then are technical tasks. The product owner has no say. It's the developers who break down the features into tasks. And as they may have broken down features into tasks, they track their implementation. As you know, we use GitHub projects for that. So that's, again, just a Kanban board. and you can see how a feature moves through the different stages here of being put into the sprint backlog during sprint planning, then being picked to be worked upon, so it makes it into the in progress column. Then when it's done, the feature ends up in awaiting review, and after a review and release meeting, it will be moved into the feature archive. Here we do not see any tasks. These are still full-blown features, but we could take each feature and, as we work on it during in progress, break it down into individual tasks. In fact, there are other Kanban boards better than GitHub's project. Here, just a Kanban board, as the software name is, which, for example, lets you have multiple boards in one. So horizontally, it is split here, where they're kind of horizontal swim lanes, and each is a Kanban board in its own right. So you could take a feature from the main Kanban board and have it broken down in tasks into another subordinate Kanban board and move it from ready through work in progress to done. So the GitHub project's software or feature is called a Kanban board, and that is the common name in which of the tool which you use to visualize your progress of finishing the features and the current sprint, and how that moves into a waiting review for the final review and release meeting of the sprint, where it gets decided whether the feature was really done. When you review it, you use the definition of done. You do not use the definition of almost done. Whenever you move something into awaiting review, you, the developer, should believe that it will pass not only the acceptance criteria, the specific to the feature acceptance criteria, but also that it will pass the definition of done. And it's really not a definition of almost done. You really need to be 100% convinced that you fulfill all the properties laid out in the feature definition of done. And I probably just ruined a perfectly good joke by explaining it too much. So next is, after you plan a sprint and break down work into tasks, in Scrum, where you may be full-time working on a project, you also have the scope of the day where you plan your day. So day planning activities are performed mostly in the daily Scrum or daily stand-up meeting, where you meet in person or maybe online these days, but synchronously, you're all there at the same time and coordinate. So you might stand around in a circle like here, and what you do in a daily stand-up or Scrum meeting is you do the rounds, and everyone shortly announces, not discusses in depth, just announces what they are going to do, or more precisely, what they did yesterday, what the current problems are, and what they are going to do today. And the purpose of that is that the others know what you're working on and can decide whether this relates to their work and might imply that they need to talk to you because there will be touch points. So it's pure announcement, not discussion. And if there are interactions that you need to talk about, you will do that after the meeting. You will not block everyone from finishing or leaving the meeting because you start a discussion in the middle. You just do the rounds, and any necessary discussion will be one-on-ones after the meeting. So, as just explained, the daily Scrum or the daily stand-up is a status meeting to sync on problems and upcoming work, and the goal is to keep it short, so 10-15 minutes usually. and you do a roll call, or you can organize it into a roll call where you say again, what did I do yesterday and finished, hopefully, what am I going to do today, and what are my current problems. Only the committed people, the pigs, as you may remember from that Scrum joke, may speak. If you really want to keep it short, maybe you don't do stand-up meetings, you do plank meetings. I think it's a joke, but you get the idea that you do not want to engage in lengthy discussions, so you make it inconvenient to stick around for too long. Maybe just for as long as you can plank. All right, so planning for software development is pretty simple. There's sprint planning and then there's day planning. So now let's look at some techniques, engineering techniques. One of the somewhat surprising features of agile methods is that you should have collective code ownership. Collective code ownership means that there is no individual person who owns a particular piece of code and is considered responsible for it. It's the whole team which is supposed to be wholly responsible for the code base. The implication is, if you have complaints, if you're an outside person, you have complaints, any one team member, software development team member, is liable. Nobody has a right to say, oh, that's somebody else's work, I can't help you. You're not allowed or supposed to say that. And this is in stark contrast to individual code ownership, where people have the thumb or the finger on a particular piece of code, are responsible for it, accept responsibility, but deny responsibility for anything else. So collective code ownership is supposed to improve the quality of the code base overall, because everyone feels wholly responsible for it. So no pulling away your feet. If you see something that's not right, it's your responsibility to point it out and possibly fix it as well. So for that, everyone has full read and write access. You don't cordon off components. It's quite different from, say, open source software, where people very clearly have a distinctive code ownership, individual code ownership, usually tied to component ownership because of the highly distributed work originally, different time zones, asynchronicity of the work. In Scrum, again, it is different. You want to instill that overall feeling of responsibility. And even though Scrum these days is as much distributed often as is open source software development, you do not introduce, because of that individual code ownership, you still want everyone to be or feel, but also be responsible for overall code quality, implying everyone needs to understand the code, everyone wants to understand it, and thereby feels responsible for its different aspects, from architecture to the individual code and tests that may be necessary. It requires really that everyone understands the code base and be able to work on all pieces of the system, which basically means that everyone should be a full stack programmer. And you can make a guess how probable that is, but this is what Scrum wants of you. For this to work, one aspect is to really follow a common programming standard so that code looks and is formatted the same wherever you look in the code base. So a programming standard is that specification of how to format your code to make reading it easier, because it's always the same, to have clear rules for writing it. And the purpose is not that there's a particular standard which is best, but rather that you have one standard that is consistently used throughout the code base so that people can learn it and use it, and thereby get efficient at reading and writing it, so that when they run into some piece of code that somebody else has written, they will easily, hopefully easily, understand it. All of this is based on the observation that code is 9 times more often read than it is written. You write a line of code and it's at least 9 times read. So making sure that your code is well written is a true investment into the future, making the life of your colleagues and yourself later on easy. So it becomes more easily comprehensible, can be navigated more easily, etc. You should make your programming standard mandatory. Here is a somewhat silly XKCD comic cartoon on that. And I think the person just so overdoes it that the complaining person so overdoes it with it complains that the person, the egghead or cue ball, I think he is called, accepts, okay, I will stick to the agreed upon programming guidelines here called style guide. It's very straightforward. I'm pretty sure most of you at this stage in your studies will have seen some. It's about how you put in comments. It's how you do line breaks, but it's also how you format, how you set your block scopes, and how you name variables, etc. And a lot of things not to do, like say here, 2 statements in the same line. Programming standards, if you take them off the web, often stop after code formatting, which I find regrettable because expert programmers have a lot of vocabulary that they use when they write code and that they use to give names. That is truly important to understand and to be able to read code fluently. The most important thing that is typically missing from programming guidelines and that I want to point out here is the naming of methods and classes and packages, modules, libraries, what have you. Mostly methods though, since this is where a lot of the reading takes place, but also field, variable, attribute names. And the method naming is based on what the methods do, and thereby also actually informs good design. So we know that there are 3 types of methods, categories of methods, if you will. Query methods, which only query an object but don't change it, so no state change is allowed or would be proper. Then mutation methods, which change the state of the object but should not return any information about the object. So they are always void in terms of the return value. And then you have helper methods, functional stuff that just does some computation and returns it. And an expert developer has in their brain etched into it from years of experience what these different method types mean. So here a very simple example that everyone knows, getters or get methods. What they do is they give you some information about an object, but should not change it. If a getter changes the object, something's wrong. And a software developer will generally assume that if they see a method that they identify as a get method, most notably because it has a get prefix in the method name, that if that method changes the object, some poor programmer was at work. Anyway, so get methods, they have a certain purpose, they belong to the category of query methods, and they are identifiable by a prefix like get. And like get methods, there are many others that you could should know. Here are assertion methods, so they might start with the word assert, and they are helper methods, so they don't change the state of an object, they just ensure that a certain condition is met. And if it's met, nothing is happening. But if it fails, the condition is not met, then an exception is thrown. That would be an assertion method. I'm not going to dive further into this, If you have not yet taken our course ADAP, Advanced Design and Programming, please do so. That's where we discuss method types, method properties, variable types, variable names, class names, these basic conventions, naming conventions that are so important to read code fluently. That's where we discuss it in detail, but not here. So here's a quiz. I will come to that in class, and that would be it. All right, build management. It was only 10 years ago that we introduced the review and release manager, as we called it back then, because in the team meetings, student teams will not even be able to build the software properly. Because, as you know, as it goes, works on my machine. I have no idea why it doesn't work on your machine. Which suggests that between the two setups, there is some different configuration going on, and that's why the build process and the resulting output works or didn't work. This has drastically changed. The tools have become so good and students so experienced that the build processes really tend to work out of the box now, but still it is effort, where you save the build configurations using appropriate build tools and pass them on from setup to setup. And the key is, whatever the machine, whatever the account, your software should build out of the box in that local environment. Whether it's developer A or developer B, the software should build, the output should be the same. Whether it's a developer's workstation, or some compilation machine, unattended build machine, the code should build, compile, so compile, build, and pass. The tests should be run, and it should all work, which requires effort, but is considered state of the art today. So you need that standardized environment. You need to turn that standardized environment into setups and configuration information, etc., and agree on this. So, as a developer, you should work only in that standardized environment, and if you make changes to it, it needs to go into the configuration management so that others benefit from it. You should never ever commit code to the repository that does not build. You'll be throwing everyone else off balance because everyone else, so you're breaking the build, but people don't necessarily know. They just pull down your changes, they check out your changes, and suddenly nothing works. And they don't know, was it me or was it somebody else? So you're costing your teammates time if you commit non-compiling code. So never break the build. If you have a continuous integration pipeline, meaning after a commit to the code repository, tests run automatically, and you break that, you cause havoc because now nobody else can run the tests any longer because you're failing them. So really only commit and push code that compiles, that works, so to the extent that you can tell it, and that also passes all the tests. And here is where it usually goes wrong. It's Friday afternoon. The weekend is winking at you. So you want to go home, but you feel like, I'd rather save my work to the server, meaning commit unfinished work. Don't do it. Or if you absolutely have to do it in some branch of yours that nobody else can access. So on a Friday afternoon, only when you have to commit, when you commit and then go home, before you do that, make sure it really works. Otherwise, your colleagues will come after you because you just broke the build, but you're gone. They will hate you for it. You don't want that. And so things that are difficult usually do not put in libraries into the code repository, really just declare your dependency. If you have to curate them by hand, do so explicitly. It's really better to just have them declared as a dependency in some Gradle or other build automation tooling setup. Another quiz for class. And that's it for this session. We shortly talked about development planning, which is pretty straightforward for developers. You plan your sprints by taking features, breaking them down in tasks, possibly. And you plan your days or you coordinate your daily's work in daily scrums or stand-ups. Beyond that, we talked about how source code and the quality of source code is important, how Scrum wants you or tells you should have collective code ownership, feel responsible for the whole code base and keep up high quality. For that, you need programming guidelines and so forth. And in the end, always be aware that you are working in a team, that the code repository is an important asset and not just a place to save work. So whenever you commit, it should be code that compiles, builds, and runs all the tests to green. That's it for now. Thank you very much for your time and attention, and we will see you in the second section of part 5, finishing the development discussion.